We're nearly halfway through May, and there hasn't been a big sell-off. So is this a good sign for the market going forward? And if so, what sectors have the best potential? Anthony Sahan is Managing Director, Research Strategy, Asia Pacific at Morningstar, and he joins me in the studio. Anthony, thanks for joining us.
Pleasure to be here, Peter.
Now, I know you want to talk about a special thing close to your analytical heart, but I know a lot of my guests would be interested, given your position at research at Morningstar,
yes.
You'd have a view. What's your feeling on the market going forward?
Look, we got a lot of analysts, do a lot of work. When we put all that stuff together, we're saying the market is probably fairly valued, if anything, probably a little bit overvalued at the moment.
Yeah.
There's going to be some volatility there. And I think the important thing is, Peter, you know, since 2011, we had a great run.
Mm.
So, you know, it's been a bit cooler for the last 6 months. But you go back, say, financial year, you know, when people get their superannuation statements, they're going to still see double-digit returns on those.
Yeah.
On those.
I think I've seen you to date, we're averaging around 13 or 14%.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's where we're positioned.
Now, the 12 months is closer to 15.
Yeah. So you come down and you look at the market, and I think, you know, you talk about financials or materials. We see particularly like stocks like BHP and Rio, we still think have a lot of long-term value there.
Yeah.
Good low-cost producers. Mm. You know, they haven't gone as well as other parts of the market over recent periods. Yeah. You then also look at the energy story, and we still think that still has some legs to run in it as well. People talk about China becoming a consumption economy. You know, you need energy for consumption. So
yes.
Gas prices, you know, yeah. I think over the long term should still rise.
Yeah.
And so that's another interesting
and
part of the market as well.
And consumer-oriented economy want to do things like go to new houses, move to new apartments and all that sort of stuff. They don't figure on those sort of things as well. Yeah. But also, that's your view, we're a little bit maybe overvalued now.
Yes.
But how long, and we know it's guesswork, but people like you and people like me, we have a view on this. How long do you reckon this bull market's got to go? Ruling out something from left field, like the GFC was the subprime thing coming from left field and debt agencies not giving us the truth
yeah.
on what we thought was going on out there. But if this kind of creeping, improving global economy keeps on going, how long can you imagine this bull market going on for?
So bull market's interesting if you want to define it, I guess, Peter. I guess a few people have. Look,
yeah.
We think there are certainly risks, and that's the problem with valuations where they're at now. It could go for a number of years. We don't think the market's about to keep roaring ahead. I mean, yeah. It can hold its ground. It can creep
slow
forward.
Grind higher.
It could be a slow grind, and that's the thing about markets, though. They always overshoot in both directions. I guess as an investor, you know, when the market shoots down, that's a chance to maybe buy, and that's the sort of environment that we're in at the moment.
So in your personal investing life, let's get personal, Anthony, even though we don't know each other very well.
Yeah.
Would you be a buyer of dips if there are some good dips and
for some of the stocks, yes, I would be.
For companies that you like?
Yeah, and I also predicate that, but I'm, you know, I don't do a lot of, I don't trade. I'm going to buy these things, I'm going to hold them for a while,
yeah.
And I have been, yeah, sure, I would do that and have been doing that.
Well, the interesting companies you mentioned earlier, BHP and Rio and stuff, they're going to do well when that dollar falls, and that will probably happen when the greenback goes up and interest rates are rising in the US.
So we've been talking about Australia. Take this a bit broader now. What we've seen finally is everybody's interested in investing offshore again. And, you know, that diversification story has been there for years.
Yeah.
People are maybe listening to a bit now because we finally had a one-year period where, geez, the dollar's dropped and global equities seem to have posted some good returns.
Yeah.
Now, that's possibly the wrong reason to start thinking about it now, but even with the dollar where it's at and with some of those diversification stories, I think people get now, okay, Australia, financial services, resources, wow, there's a lot of other stuff out there, the dollars, you know, depending where that goes. So I think people are showing a lot more interest investing offshore as well, and there's a lot more ways you can do it now, which is, I think, another appealing thing for investors.
Okay, let's go to the fact that you're an analyst and there's a thing called the CFA Society, or
yes.
Societies, plural,
yeah,
of
yeah.
Australia. What is that?
So CFA stands for Chartered Financial Analyst. Okay, so the CFA societies, there's societies in Sydney, Melbourne and Perth, and they're largely made up of people who have passed the qualifications to be a Chartered Financial Analyst or use that designation.
So there are different qualities of analysts, and the best or best qualified would be a chartered one.
We would argue that. We think CFA is a global organisation. That's the first thing. It's in 143 countries. It stands, I think, for excellence in financial services. Yeah. And it's importantly, ethics has always been a very important part of what that organisation is about as well.
Well, a station like this one here and the viewers who watch this show, they rely very heavily on what analysts say individually and as a group.
Yes.
You know, I know Ron Bewley, one of my best commentators, he gets access to 1,000 analyst views to actually get an idea of what the market's thinking and all that sort of stuff. So analysts are really important. But how many are out there? And I'm thinking stockbrokers, sure, had analysts, and so did financial institutions and then foreign exchange divisions and all that stuff. Analysts are everywhere.
Oh, yeah, it'd be tens of thousands in Australia.
Yeah.
I mean, I was talking about our membership in Australia, and we're quite a small organisation. We probably have a little bit under 2,000 within Australia. Globally, there's 112,000. Mm. But put some context around that. We've got 3,000 people in a few weeks sitting the exams across three levels.
Really?
3,000. We've got two under
in Australia.
So obviously,
a lot more globally. Obviously, a lot of analysts are taking you seriously.
Yes,
your qualifications are worthwhile having. And I guess the really big institutions, unless you've got unbelievable track record and you need to be qualified, even though it would be nice if you were.
Yes.
The facts are young people will be looking for that qualification.
They do. And it's a global, but I think the other thing, it's a global qualification. And it's respected. It's hard to get. You know, only I think 1 in 5 people who start this program actually get it through to the end.
They end up an analyst themselves if they can't get through.
Yeah.
All right. Now tell us about, Investor First Week. What's all this about?
Okay, look, as a group of analysts, we recognise that trust, as you say, is an important part, and as an industry, we need to regain some of the trust. There was clearly some trust lost during the financial crisis.
Yeah.
This week is just about standing up and saying, look, ethics are a really important part of what we do, and we have a lot of material that can help the industry become, I think, adopt better practices. And we also want to communicate to end investors to help them understand that they have rights. And when they walk through the door, today we talked about the Statement of Investor Rights. It's a one-pager that the CFA Institute has put together, and it's about giving investors some power when they walk through the door to say, you know what, I'm entitled to all these things. And we want to speak to investors, and we also want to speak to everybody across the industry to encourage a higher standard.
When you use the word walking through the door,
yes,
give me an example of where an investor walks through a door and they are relying heavily on what an analyst is saying.
Yep. So this is typically happens more so at the whether it's you're seeking some financial advice on what you want to do, whether you're engaging with a stockbroker about maybe your share portfolio. They're probably the two most common examples.
Yep. And a financial advisor and a stockbroker ultimately will cite work by analysts.
They will.
Okay. And I guess the argument is, in the past, some analysts may well have been influenced by other factors to talk a company up, when in actual fact, an objective analysis, you would say, why in the hell is he doing that?
Yeah, I do. And look, and can I even go further back than the analyst? Investor relies on an advisor, relies on an analyst. An analyst might rely on an issuer of securities.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a whole chain in here, and you need
CEO and an CFO and all that sort of stuff as well.
Any weak link can break the whole chain and impact on trust. So we will talk a lot about that consumer level, but it's got to feed all the way back as well, Peter. And that's why, and when we talk about this, look, there's clearly a regulatory response you can look at. What we want to talk about is just the basic common principles, ethics. And, so, and if you've got it, it's a good thing and it'll be good for your business.
Okay, so this Investor First Week, you're asking people like my viewers if they want to go to this first week.
We're saying we're using this week we've run a number of events, but this is really about education. Education's a big part of what we're doing. We want to get exposure, and we want to, raise the education levels.
Yeah. And where is the event being held?
Well, it's being held in all across. We've had
in every city of the country.
Well, not in every city of the country, but we held events, as I said, in Perth, Melbourne, Sydney last week.
Okay.
In the lead-in.
All right. Now we're out of time, but if people want to know about this, obviously there's a lot of online stuff here as well. So so where do they go?
You go to just look up either CFA Institute.
Yeah.
Or CFA Societies of Australia,
yeah.
Or even type in Investor First Week, and you will get into your browser.
Investor First Week.
Yeah, and you'll get some information.
Okay,
really appreciate it, Peter. Thanks.
Fantastic. Thanks for coming on the program, and good luck with it.
Cheers.
Okay, after break, in the space race of the 21st century, Australia has its own participant, the little Aussie company with sky-high ambitions. Up next.